the wonder of sunset at evening, the wonder of sunrise I see. By the wonder of wonders that thrills my soul.
Bless God for the grace and His ability, and the way He has been guiding us all this way through this series, which I entitled The Rich Man That Will Make Heaven. We want to really bless God because of this chance, for the opportunity which He has granted us to go through them. Now, all this while, the previous videos, we have treated three different types of hearts and their mindset. And our major reading, where we drew our reference from, was the book of Luke chapter 16, verse 11 to verse 13. And these three different type of mindset, actually and vividly, we are drawn from actually the majorly two phrases in that portion of the Bible, whereby the Bible gave us a simple illustration here, telling us something about the rich man, these four types of mindset. Then we dwelt our mind and our thoughts on verse number 13, which says, "No servant can serve two masters." Then the phrases, these two phrases I'm going to read now, give us what we're looking for. "For either he will hate the one and love the other." All right. Now, from this particular phrase, we saw two different mindsets isolated. The person who loves God, the person who loves mammon and hates God, we call that person the free thinker, that is the atheist, the person who feels he does not, there's no God, God is not part of his life. We treated that in video number one. And we now saw the second type of mindset, the person who says he does not need mammon, that he loves God, yet inside he is a miserable person because life is forcing him to tell him that you really need mammon, you need wealth. And for that reason, we saw that that second type of heart constitutes the largest proportion of human beings on earth who are living miserably on earth and will end up dying and going to hell. They won't even make it. In fact, it's difficult to find the rich people among them, but this is another type of wealth mindset because they're miserable. Yet among them, there are people, I am sure, God has marked for riches and wealth, but that their mindset, that the Lord God, they don't need wealth, has deprived them of many things. Now, we now saw the second portion of the scripture, and that is the one that says here, and love the other, okay, and then, or else he hold to one and despise the other one. In other words, he relate to both, but he committed to one, and then the other one is not really interested in it. We saw two different kinds of people who have wealth mindset towards that. The person who claims that he actually loves money, but still claims that he still needs God. He still relates with God. He wants me to believe that he is a child of God. But his real devotion is on money. It's actually on wealth. It's on mammon. He only uses God to cover the top. We don't call that kind of person the wicked heart or the deceitful heart, the deceitful mind with his own mindset. We treated that in video number three. And today we are now coming to the last part of this particular segment, and that is what the one that actually loves God, yet they still say, "I can use money, wealth to solve problems, but I am not devoted to it. My devotion is to God." This one we call it the godly what? Man wealth mindset, or the godly mind wealth mindset. Now, in this is where we are going to center our discussion for today. And for that, therefore, I want to crave your indulgence, give me attention, let us read from the scripture and see what the Lord has.
King of Jesus, He is King of kings. Lift up Jesus, He is Lord of
lords. Our reading today will be taken from the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter number 10. All right, we are going to read from verse 31 to verse 33. Pay attention to this reading, just one place we are reading today. And it has three verses. It says, "Whether therefore ye eat or drink," no, okay, do eat or drink, "or whatever ye do, Do all to the glory of God. Give none offense, neither to the Jews or to the Gentiles, nor to the church of God, even as I please all men in all things, not seeking my own profit, but the profit of men, that they may be saved. This is the mindset of a good man. Everything he does, whatever he or she does, is purely centered on what? Pleasing God, glorifying God, and being a blessing to humanity. That is the activity, the work of a man who, by the mercies of God, has been designed to either control wealth or to live like that. Under this, there are two categories of people there. The first one is the person who said, I am not interested in money. I don't need it. I am content with my life. Whether he is poor or he is rich, he doesn't care. If money comes, no problem. There is no way you will make him to like money. And there is no way you will make him to envy those who have it. Nor does he talk negative things about this. See what the Bible says here? Give offense to none. He does not find offense with anybody, whether to the Christians or to unbelievers, whether they are born again or not born again. He doesn't find offense to God, any of them. Even the church, he doesn't have time finding out how things are done in the church to be offended, to pick offense from the way. You know, like people who go about asking, attacking pastors and preachers and everything today. He has no time wasting his time looking into those things and worrying himself about the life of other people. Whether they have the money or not have the money, don't care. There are people like that who are content. I want those who are preaching the Bible to hear me. Stop insulting Christians who have chosen to live their lives in penury, who have chosen to live their life without enjoying the beautiful amenities that the world can give. There are people who have decided to live like that and are willing to go to heaven, enjoying nothing. They don't bother about it. All they want is to live and do their work as much as they are, render services to men. You might attack them and say they are not blessing to humanity. You may not know the kind of people God is using their lifestyle to bless, to really solve a problem, to encourage and to minister. But when you climb pulpit, you use your mouth and render it look useless. You will insult them. You will use the people in second mindset. Those people who say, I don't love God, I don't love money, I love God. They really crave, they yearn to have money. You use them and begin to embarrass, insult, and make people to use as if they are useless, unimportant, miserable people on earth. And at the point, we cause most of them to fall in defeat. We force greed in them, we force doubt in them. They begin even to see themselves as idiots, as fools, for living a life just content with whatever little that they have every day. And have you noticed those people? They are the happiest people here on earth. Why do they have the world? You don't have peace. You are afraid of thieves. You are afraid of robbers. You are afraid of many things. Are you hearing me? Now, there are some other people whom God has also given money. He gave it to them. We didn't give it to them. Illuminati did not give them the money. No native doctor or ritual gave it to them. God gave them because he gave them the idea, gave them the method, gave them everything. And they are wealthy, extremely wealthy. No matter how wealthy they are, they don't lay hand on that money. It doesn't scratch their brain, and they are extremely wealthy, yet they are purely serving the Lord. You will never notice in them anything. In fact, sometimes we think that they are people controlling that wealth because of their life. Their number one hunger is God. Any other thing doesn't work. Money to them is a messenger. It is not something to pride. It's not something to boast with. It's not something to show about. And that is why we will have to look at that. As the Bible says here, even as all, I try to please men. That's their number one desire, to make men happy. Whether you are working for them or you are not working for them, the goodwill of others is their interest. Seeking not my own profit, even though they have wealth, whatever they do is not because they want to make profit for themselves, but it's to profit other people. So if you see them making millions, that million is to be channeled through a process that will result to other people. A story was told about John Wesley, the founder of Methodist Church. We are told that that man traveled more than 100,000 kilometers on horseback trying to evangelize the land of the whole of England. There is no amount of money he didn't receive. But after the man had died, the wife testified that when they checked his bank account, being a wealthy preacher as he was when he was alive, but when they checked his bank account, the only thing that was found was $150. They asked the wife, what did he use the money for? He said, my husband doesn't touch money. The moment you send money to him, he gets all the money, he dispatches it. If it's not for missions work, it is for somewhere where the money will bless lives. John Wesley was wealthy, but nobody knew because the money was coming, he was sending it where it's supposed to be. Now you can see our churches today, they find fault with wealthy churches, and members in that particular church are trying to defend their pastors. You buy aircraft, people start asking questions, which village will aircraft enter? You buy helicopter, okay, we're going to village. How many people will you preach? I know those people. We keep talking, but yeah, the way you live your life becomes envious. It's making even your members to envy you as a pastor, as a preacher. And by that, they see themselves as miserable people. And by then, they begin to look for a way to become like you. Eh, I must become like my papa now. I must become like him. At the end of the day, people, you will be, when you die, you will leave millions and billions and other things on earth, in your bank account, everything you have after your name. But actually, rather than blessing many people with that money, we see that you claim that yes, you are only managing God's resources and God's wealth, but your lifestyle actually is producing more greedy people, more impatient people than holy and heavenly saints here on earth. So let us look at the behaviors and the characters of these people. In fact, in this topic, I did not separate their characters from their relationship with God because their characters and their relationship with God are the same. They merge together. There is nothing you can separate from the two. They are the same thing. Number one, it is only at the feet of God that their true emotion comes out. Meaning, they are both, they do, you see, their true devotion to God, their true commitment to God, yes, that's what I have here, is deep and true. You can see somebody who is commanding millions. But the moment he goes on his knees to pray, his million don't come near his head. His societal reputation doesn't make sense. At that moment, you can see him weep. You can see him cry. You can see him shed tears. You can see him admit his own sins. You can see him pour like liquid. Even though he has 100,000 workers under him, even though he's paying 1 million people under him, he is assigning their salary every month, you will see him dissolve. He's at the feet of God when you see him worship. When you see him singing worship song, he does not miss a day. He always makes our time to stay with God. He doesn't miss anything. He devotes himself to fellowship with God. And he loves to do that. By himself, not delegating it to other people, not hiring people and say, pray for me, do this for me. In fact, he doesn't even use audio Bible, he uses written one. He reads it, not the one that you sit and lie down at your comfort and the thing will play and you'll be listening to the reading. No, he reads it as part of self-discipline. He does that by himself. That is, he's at the feet of God to see his true humility. He will dissolve there. And that is why God corrects. Even in his words, God will be able to show to him where he's getting through. And he will correct, take corrections and stand up. When he comes out, the glory shines forth more. Number two, wealth and worldly things do not make any influence or affect their emotions to an uncontrollable degree that people can be affected by negatively. Meaning, they are not slaves to wealth. There's no how wealth, anything. If something they have, something goes bad, they may feel bad about it, but you wouldn't notice it. Their reaction will show maturity. They will use every other godly reason to explain why that thing happened. And rather than allow that to take away their peace, they will instead find a way to put it aside and say, let's go, life goes like that, it's like that. Their loss of millions of billions doesn't cause headache to them. It doesn't break them. If any of their vehicle break down or it happens, if somebody breaks in and steals, they know it is thief, robbery. Correct. If the thief is scandal, hand them over to the people who are responsible, who can take care of that. But apart from that, if you see these human beings, even if anything bad happens, they see it as the activities of the evil world, the badness of the world we live in. And rather than taking away their peace, making them being angry, even transferring that anger as aggression to their own workers or to themselves, to their friends, they will just put aside this normal way of life. Sometimes this is where I normally give credit to the Muslim people. Yes, you will see, like we are told the story of a man who went to mosque. You know, they normally you leave their shoes outside. And while they were staying Salah outside, some people normally rush out to come on time and take the shoe that's not their own, new ones or expensive ones. Now this man, they said he drove his expensive car and parked it somewhere and wore a very costly shoe to the mouth of the mouse. But the moment he came out, he discovered his shoe has been taken. Going to where he parked his vehicle, it has been broken open and somebody drove the car away. People reacted, people shouted and talked, a Muslim, I didn't say a Christian, a Muslim. Told them, what is the problem? He spoke in Hausa like I would say now. And he said, Haka Allah Yasu, What does it mean? This is how God wants it. Just forget it. This is how God wants it. And it wasn't long, the same man bought a jeep, more expensive than the one that was stolen. But our own self, kind of, can you imagine among Christians? Small car broke down, the driver will survive it. And robbers attack, they say it's carelessness. Something happened, you will find somebody you must deal with. These people don't allow their words to touch their emotions to an uncontrollable level. I didn't say it doesn't touch their emotions, it does, but not to an uncontrollable level. They allow maturity to control them. And that is it, because they look at how their action will affect the other person who is looking up to them. Therefore, they are careful in their choices. And I have said this, if you are a wealthy man who pick your face at any damages that happen at your wealth, your source of wealth may be questionable. The way you got it must be a very, very favorable way. May the Lord help us all in Jesus. Number three, they use wealth in their custody to promote only what is good. Yes, you can't see them put it in better. You can't see them invest it in something that is good. Nobody who is wealthy will be sponsoring any event like drinking competition, gambling. You can be sponsoring even beauty pageant. You'll be sponsoring worldly music concerts, comedians who are using lies to make people laugh. You put your money there because you're going to get gain from there. You invest it there. It's part of investment. Anything is investment. It's a legitimate investment. In the world system, it is a legitimate one. But then you go and put it there. Before God is not, you are sponsoring evil. There are a lot of talents around that needs that help. They need that. No, you go and sponsor it somewhere. They are looking people who are godly in their own way. Put their money where it is right. Where God will be happy when he sees your money put there. Where the devil will be offended. If you are looking for a place, please, we have the church. The missionary work is there. And they say there's nothing they're going to get from you. Yes, because if you are saying like that, please don't believe that God will. He who invested the money to his God, not man. And if God is the one that says, I give you the power to get wealth, invest it there. Invest it there if you have extra money to invest there. I didn't say go and keep your business. No, run your business. But if you want to make you have extra money for investment, put some of them there. Put them for talent. There are young people around begging for somebody to help them sponsor their books, publish their books, sponsor their music. Even with your own strength, you can be able to connect them to some of the music companies that can publish, wax their songs and they sell it. Is it wrong that you help them? There are people who are looking for admission. You can sponsor them. There are many of them. But there are some people who sponsor for selfish reasons, maybe for political reason or for personal discovery. But the godly man can do this thing, you know he's the person doing it. Yes, there are a lot of them. Orphanage, you call. We have a lot of things like that. They don't put their money where something is bad. Number four, they listen to everyone where the chance puts them. And so they do all things to make those within their reach comfortable to some reasonable degree. Yes. If you come to them, they listen, meaning they are humble. Very humble, they listen. If you are rebuking them, they will listen. No matter the amount of money, they listen to you. Let's say the chance is not there. But if the time is there available, they listen to you. And listen, they make sure that nobody plays middleman. Even if there are middlemen, people who you have to meet before you see them, they make sure they make the movement very easy because they will trace every dubious character there and remove them. Who may make life difficult for people who will need to see them? How yes, they can press strategic time between this and this. I will make myself available to anybody who wants to see me. Please, the poor should be able to see, and the rich should be able to see. We know that it's a human being. Because a wealthy person, we all know also that the people will be too much. Delegated. You can write names. First to come, first to serve. You can write them and tell them, these are number of people that you attended to. People can book out. If 100,000 people come, put them in the list. Write down your name, we take it. So you can tell them, please, because it's one man, this is the time that he can listen to everybody. Please, can you write that? Today, he is attending only to 20 people. So according to the number you own, count the days and know the day you're going to come. And people, we can organize these things like that. But you see somebody, even the person you meet at the gate, there is a dubious person, mischievous man, who have a way lying here and there to make sure that even he defraud the person coming before the person gets to see the meeting. What are we saying? They make sure that they try as much as they can to listen to big churches and listen to small churches, listen to big organizations and small ones, talented names, popular celebrities, as well as the upcoming and little ones who are not yet known. They listen to all. And they make sure that whatever they're doing is going to end up in glorifying God. In most cases, even if you come to them and they discover what you have is of God, they will advise you. on had to reshape your thinking so that it will fit into the plan of God and the good of mankind. Not somebody that is, you see, is not even born again and comes around, and the person is not even a child of God, is looking for the wealth of a good child of God to sponsor his own wedding music. In that case, there has to be counseling and guidance. If you will need the money of God, you have to be a child of God first. You have to put you in the right place. You have to pass him through. Of course, a person, I know people can pretend just to get people, want to get the money. Of course, that he can't just get people. You have to get mature Christians to deal with such kind of human beings. When they are truly born again, we will know. Anyone will know. And that is when they will get the help that they require. And we will make agreement between them and God that only heaven can ratify. All right. Number six. Now, okay, number five. They are content with what they have, be it big or small. Okay? Or none of it, even if they don't have any, because they see a greater wealth waiting for them in heaven. So if one is counting, today his financial status is 10 billion. He is content with it. And he will be running business and his lifetime with it. If the money appreciates, thank God. If it depreciates, thank God. If he's poor, bam, that is what we're talking about. Do not insult people and raise up more impatient and greedy human beings. Stop this thing. Preachers, please stop it. You are causing more havoc to God in your so-called attempt to get richer people in the church. In the name of, let us make a house of God wonderful. You go and put something and have a somewhere. Bring it and begin to cause trouble for the body of Christ. Instead of bringing more Christians, you are bringing more impatient human beings to God. Number six, they monitor their actions in line with how they affect other people around them and those watching them. So you can start how they watch, even the clothes they wear. They don't have to put up something that will make people start talking. Ah, this one too. Nah, this money is very rich. They can wear. They don't wear a shirt that will make somebody to become greedy, or a shirt that will make them to look stupid before that. Make some. Ah, yes, you know, okay, you can't please everybody, but they wear a shirt, a dress, appearance, attitude, and behavior that the greater average people who see them will say, this man is humble. This woman is a child of God. Once you see her, the grace of God is there. And you will notice people who come around, they will not praise them because they are wealthy. They will praise them because they are some example of godliness. So we see this is it. Number seven, they trust God. They trust God more than their trust in God is second to none anywhere. Because they live by discernment and not by their own thinking and strategies. Their trust is on God. That is why if they have to invest in something, they face prayerful unto God, guides them, lead them, and when they invest in God, will put his hand there and you see it blow. They don't go about planning it the way they feel they can plan it. Yes, sometimes they can plan, but that is when they are sure this is God's way, this is God's plan, this is what God wants them to do. They now sit down and arrange how to go about it. And after that, they hand it over to someone, face their service and fellowship with God. And things will begin to run naturally. God will now come to the other side and bless it. And it will bear more fruit. They trust God beyond any other thing. You can't make them to start looking onto human being as a method. Even if there's a human being that comes with an idea, they see that as God using him as an instrument to talk to them. Of course, they have to weigh the idea in line with the way God wants. These are people that God uses. These are wealthy men, good men, godly men, their own mindset. Whether they are rich or poor, that is the attitude number eight. They hate evil in any form of it, be it innocent, seemingly, or outrightly evil. And then they make sure they remove that and hate anything that will bring around it. You know, there are some people that look in these things innocent. Evil can look innocent. You can do it, yes. There's nothing bad about that. They hate it. For instance, examination or practice. You can do it. Nothing wrong about that. Nobody sees it after. It's not those things. They hate evil to its core. And even if the thing is looking like evil, appearances of evil, they hate it. And if they discover you have body language that is suspicious in nature, they will distance themselves from you. Long straightforward. Then when they see correct evil physically, correct, natural one, evil committed, that one is part of their head. They don't like it. And that is why they don't allow themselves to be drawn into such kind of thing. They are transparent to people. Number nine, they are truthful and so are their policies, principles, and ways of dealing with other people. They are true. Whatever they say is true. They don't look up to man or anything that is questionable. They are very, very honest in their dealing with man, very transparent. If they say yes, it is yes. If they say no, it is no. So anywhere they do their principle, the way they guide their life is like that. There's nothing you can do to put a scar in their life. And that is why they can make heaven, because they are careful about their interaction with men. They know that God will judge them based on their relationship with people, things around them, and with himself. That is it. So they are very, very, very careful and cautious of these things. Number 10, they find happiness only when they have affected the lives of other people positively and or when they have promoted the things of God. That is when they are happy. Their greatest joy is there, not when they set up party, not when they go for any event or something that they are singing and dancing, or invite musicians to come and sing and praise them. No, their joy and gladness come when they have done these two things. Bless the life of men and bless God and His kingdom. And that is what they live every day to pursue. A truthful and a godly child of God does that. He will do everything possible to promote you and will never ever in any way do anything that will promote you, that will make people to start talking negative things about him. That is the attitude of such key people. Now, if you look at it, verse number 11 now says, they carry an aura of God's presence anywhere they go. Yes, you see it. You know, there's somewhere in the Bible where the Bible tells that Jesus Christ was moving. People who were following from behind looked at him. And they could not just understand. Teacher, this man is too glorious. Blessed is the breast that he saw. Jesus turned back and told them, no, rather, blessed is the man who does what my Father has asked me, asked people to do. What is it? There is something that looks like cloud. There is a beauty that comes from heaven. It is called the glory of God. There's something that used to follow through children of God. That when you look at them, the moment your eye falls on them, you have an impression, you have a touch, you have a feeling, you have a thought. There is this kind of thing that really envelopes you to tell you that this person I'm seeing is clean. This is a true child of God. You may have not known the person, you may not even know the person, but the first time you see, the first impression you have is that this is a child of God. This is a very deep child of God. Being a wealthy person, when you see him, that aura is there. That glory from God is there. It's not missing. When you see a poor person, the presence of God is there. He is doing everything for himself. And he's carrying this glory wherever he goes. Because the Lord is with him. That is it. He carries the aura of God wherever he goes. And lastly, they do not enter into a deal that is not clear. Would I suggest something suspicious is hidden behind it. In the process, how to profit, no matter how, even if it's going to profit them or not. There's nothing you can do to drag them into a question of duty. Once they don't understand it, it's not clear to them. They suspect something mischievous, something unclear, something suspicious is going to follow this thing. They will not come into it. And there's nothing you can do to drag them into it. That is how they will stop you. Therefore, this day, brethren, having considered this heart, now I want to call upon everyone who may have listened to all the four topics in this series, saying, which one do you want to choose? Is it the man who believes that he doesn't need God, and so he conditions his life by his thinking, he decides the way he lives, he designs his own thinking, forgetting that actually the mindset he claims he has is given to him by the devil himself. Is controlled, so he cannot do without spirit. The devil is there suggesting, telling him that he is a free person. There's no need of God. Is it the kind of person you want? You know your end. Because you don't need God, you will definitely end in hell. Second one is the person who claims he doesn't need help, God, wealth, let's go. Young man, if you don't need God, why not move yourself to the fourth man? Person who doesn't bother about it. Why not live a comfortable, be content with yourself? Why are you worried about other people? Why do you bother yourself like David said, as we read in Psalm 34, that I nearly died, I nearly fall because of the wealth, the riches of the ungodly. Why are you so worried? No, God says today, repent. Please repent. Come home. Come home. It's possible you are one of those people whom Jesus has appointed to be wealthy. That you are there dying quietly in your self-righteousness. Instead of learning the true things and learning how you are to manage the wealth of God. And you lose that wealth to the glory of God and still make it that heaven that you're talking about. Or are you talking about the person who is a deceitful man? My dear, please repent. You are one of the worst human beings on earth. And it's your among you, we have the wealthiest group of people here on earth today. People who gather riches and wealth. Yes, we are among the people who have many of them. A greater portion of the world's wealthy wealthy men belong is among you people. And today, we are speaking to you people saying, repent. Give your life to Jesus Christ. Submit to His discipline. Go into His, let God train you so that you can now know how to shift your mind to the godly mindset. And stop being a slave to wealth. Stop being a slave to what people say. And then you'll be free. Then, to the people who are God, who carry the mind of God, please continue. It is for your sake that this message is prepared. Continue. Do not lose hope. Even when people misinterpret it, don't lose hope. Be open, share with them, because your ways of getting money is clear to you. The way you are controlling it is clear to you. People will speak bad about you. But remember that your lifestyle will always outshine their evil. The Lord will always be your grace, will always support you in everything that you do. And as you do these things, the Lord will bless you. I want to therefore use this moment to say, if you have been following my tutorial on this YouTube, please, you will do me a favor by liking this video and subscribe to the video channel. Yes, do well and subscribe to it. I will appreciate that. When you subscribe, please share the video so that more other people can be reached. They can hear this message if it has blessed your heart. It can be able to lift us from the level we are into becoming the instrument God wants us to become. And from this day, we can be able to render God the blessed promises He has given to us. He will bless you, use you as a blessing to Himself, to God, to mankind, to everybody, and to yourself. And when we return to heaven, it shall be a glorious day that God gave us what? Gave you wealth. And then says, you use it well. And then your wealth will be multiplied. Therefore, I want to ask you the question God asked me when He first spoke to me about these four hearts. Choose which one you want to become this day. To this, therefore, I say thank you for listening. And may the Lord, who has given us this message, bless and glorify His name in our life. Thank you for listening, and God bless you. In Jesus' name.
Who sing angels are singing, praise the Lord.